try to sing it as often as possible. No one here to guide you. Now you're on your own. Only me beside you. Still you're not alone. No one is alone. Truly, no one is alone. Sometimes people leave you halfway through the book. Others may deceive you. You decide what's good. You decide alone. But no one is alone. People make mistakes. Fathers, mothers, people to their own, thinking they're alone. Honor their mistakes. Everybody makes one another's terrible mistakes. Witches can be right. Decide what's right. You decide what's good. Just remember, someone is on your side. Someone else is not. While you're seeing your side, you forgot they are not alone. No one is alone. You just move a finger, say the slightest word. Let it go. Things will turn out right now. We can make it so. Someone is on.
Let it be light.
feel blue, you feel lonely and in grief. You feel every kind of feeling but the feeling of relief. You feel hungry as the wolf felt when he met Red Riding Hood. What don't you feel? You don't feel good. Lots of things in life are beautiful, but brother, there is one particular thing that is nothing whatsoever in any way, shape, or form, or anything else, like any other. You need a bow? There is absolutely nothing like the frame. You didn't think I was going to pick it. Dang, he's cute, isn't he? There are no books like a dame, and nothing looks like a dame. There are no drinks like a dame, and nothing thinks like a dame. And he looks down, and there's a frog. And the frog says, "Mister, a witch put a spell on me. But if you kiss me, I promise you I'll turn into a voluptuous blonde, and I'll make sweet love to you tonight and every night for the rest of your life." So the man takes the frog, puts it in his pocket, and runs home. He gets in bed, and he puts the frog on the nightstand, and he goes to sleep. And the frog says, Mister, I don't think you understood. One kiss, one tiny little kiss, I turn into a voluptuous blonde and I make sweet love to you tonight and every night for the rest of your life. And he said, "Well, to be perfectly honest, at my age, I prefer a talking frog." And that's the joke section.
Yeah.
I think about you and do Will you just be kind? Or am I losing my mind? I want you so, it's like I'm losing my mind. Does no one know? It's like I'm losing my mind. Afternoon, doing every little chore. Just being kind, or am I losing my careful the things you say, children will listen. Careful the things you do, children will see and learn. Children may not obey, but children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn, to learn what to be. Careful before you say, listen to me. Children will listen. Careful the wish you make. Wishes are children. Careful the path they take. Wishes come true, not free. Careful the spell you cast, not just on children. Sometimes the spell may last past what you can see and turn against you. Careful the tale you tell, that is the spell. Children will listen, dabble with what is true, and children will turn if just to be free. Careful before you say, listen to me. Children will listen. Listen. Before the parade passes by, I am going to get some life back into my life. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna I reversed those, didn't I? Let's keep going. I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life. I'm ready to move out in front. The rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. Oh, I gotta go again, I gotta drive again. I wanna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by. With a crown up ahead, Horace, please. Wave your little hand and whisper, so long, dearie, you ain't gonna see me anymore. But when you discover that your life is dreary, don't you come on knocking at my door. For I'll be all grown up and singing that song, just a song, I told you so. It's a little lumpy, but it rings. So come and knock and I'll be all done up and sing that song that says you know I told you so. So always you will find your life a sad old story when you see your dolly shuffle off to glory. Thank you. isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair, sending the clouds. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing around, one who can't move. Where are the clouds? Send in the clouds. Just when I'd stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours, making my entrance again with my usual flair, sure of my lines. No one is there. Don't you love farce? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear, but where are the clowns? Quick, send in the clowns. Don't bother rich. Isn't it queer losing my timing this late in my career? But where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe next support for being alive.
Well, Norm Lewis. I love Norm Lewis. He has the most beautiful voice, and he has the most beautiful soul. He's a lovely, lovely, lovely person. So I loved working with him. I actually did Sondheim. We did a show with Wynton Marsalis' orchestra. It was called A Bed and a Chair. It was wonderful. And then Santino Fontana came into Hello Dolly, and we had a ball. He was trying to make me laugh all the time, but he was great.
Did he succeed? Did he break it?
Yeah. He didn't laugh, but he got to me a couple of times. I think I've done most of them. You know, it's so funny. Steve would go, what was the one? Sometimes someone would say, you know, she should do a little night music. And he'd go, maybe. And then all of a sudden it would hit him. And he'd see me and he'd go, you have to go into a little night music. You know, all of a sudden he sees me in the role. But he didn't see me, you know, unless he was writing it for me, right away in things. So I guess the only last one I hadn't done was Mrs. Lovett, but I don't know even if, I don't know, you know, I mean, there are, that's the only one I guess I didn't, I haven't done.
Would you like to?
You know, yeah. I have to be honest, I was never drawn to it. I have to be honest about that, but you know, he writes such interesting things, and I could kick it around.
Is there a musical theater role, let's say for a male character or some other role that you would maybe not be cast in many cases for whatever reason that you have always wanted to play?
Is there a male role?
Yeah, for instance, like something that you would maybe not generally be cast in that you've always thought, I'd love to have a go at that or to sing that song.
Oh, I'd play Sweeney Todd.
Yeah. Do you know when I was here on the cruise last year, Alan Cumming was here, and he said, no, I don't want to play Sweeney, I want to play Mrs. Lovett. So maybe that's our revival.
Yeah, no, I've been pretty lucky, I have to say, and I've been given such wonderful roles to play, and I'm usually in love with each one as I'm doing it, so.
Of the Tony Awards you have won, one of them was for your charitable works with Broadway Parks. Can you tell us a little bit about sort of what the impetus was for that and the co-finding it and why it was so important to you?
Well, we had lost our beloved golden retriever, and it was time we wanted to go and adopt a dog from a shelter. So we went to the ASPCA and we got Kramer, and then we went to the city shelter, and then we realized how much help they needed. They needed so much help. They had cages in the hallways, you know, on top of each other. And they had amazing dogs there. They had purebreds. They had beautiful dogs that for some reason became homeless. They weren't bad dogs. They weren't bad animals. And I was talking to my dear friend Mary Tyler Moore about it. And then when I was in Annie Get Your Gun, thank you. We had won Gypsy of the Year, or the Easter Bonnet, actually, and we were feeling really good, and we were saying, well, what else could we do? And I said, we went to the city shelter, and they really need some help. And so we came up with the idea of doing an adoption event in Schubert Alley, and I called Jerry Schoenfeld at the time, and he just was worried about who's going to pick up the poop, but we assured him that that was not a problem. And Mary got on board, and all the celebrities, it's now become their event. They come out from the Broadway shows, and they have a great day, and they have a great time. And it's actually like, it's really pet therapy. Yeah. and you feel like, how can I do a show and come up between, and then you feel so good to go back to do the show. And now we actually, during the pandemic, I called my friend Elaine Page in London, and we did West End Wolves. We did it virtual, but this year, when I was in London, we did it live. So we took it to London to help the dogs there, and nothing could make me more proud than this charity that we started. Yeah. A lot of television as a child, and I was really lucky because Ed Sullivan was on. And Ed Sullivan used to have all the Broadway shows on, and but I think what really inspired me to sing is I used to watch all the, we had great TV specials too back then with like Lena Horne and Tony Bennett and Frank Sinatra, and they were so great that, you know, then you'd end up singing to yourself in the bathroom mirror, all that kind of music. But I kept thinking I went to all the Broadway shows, but we didn't, because we had enough money either for lessons or go to Broadway. So we took the lessons, but I was watching Broadway on Ed Sullivan all those years. So all those performers that would come through and do numbers from Broadway were just, that's what got me to Broadway. I was in a off-Broadway show called Dames at Sea. And you see, that's where I got my training. So when I would come home from, it was about a 1930s, it was a takeoff. It was on 1930s musicals, camp. But when I would come home from school at 3 o'clock, the million-dollar movie was on at 4 o'clock, and that's what they showed. They showed those movies from the 30s and the 40s, so I knew exactly how to walk, how to stand, how to do the whole thing. And so when I was in that show, all of a sudden, and it was a big hit. It was off Broadway, but it was downtown, but it was in New York, and it was a big hit. People started talking to me in the street. And I'm going, oh my God, people are talking to me now in the street. I felt like I just had more friends, you know. But I realized that, oh, this is fun, you know. I have more friends in the world. But I guess, in a way, that kind of made me realize that now I was, you know, not quite as anonymous, but it was joyful. It was fun. And I'm not going to tell you the role that I regret doing. You'll have to figure it out.
Darn.